primal forces of nature, Mr. Beale, and you will atone.
Now to growing concerns about the deadly coronavirus officially hitting the U.S. Here's what we know.
We really need to take strong actions here to try to move to contain this, to be testing, to be tracing, to be isolating patients, emphasizing social distancing, everything that governments can do to potentially slow the spread here.
First of all, I mean, as we know, the World Health Organization just declared this a global health emergency. For Americans who are watching this, how serious is this? What's keeping you up at night?
A good friend of mine, pork chopped the dog.
The nation erupted into scenes of chaos, violence. City became a war zone. After attempting to breach television studios, large groups torched police cruisers.
What's up, dude?
Find the rightful democratic victory of his political opponent. This is a video of a crowd chanting, "Hang Mike Pence."
Should this start the show?
Yeah, let's start it. We're doing it.
Should we just, for a second, just take a moment and just enjoy this new show?
It's Friday, it's 10:30, it's time to party.
Welcome to the Final News Boys.
Final News Boys, here we go.
Final News Boys.
No! No!
don't ask why. It's not a question, but a lesson learned in time. It's something unpredictable.
How's it going, man?
But in the end is right. I hope you had the time of your life.
Al, how are you? Jim Biederman, the executive producer of The Whitest Kids You Know and many others. Here we go.
So take Jim, the photographs and still burns in your
welcome
mind.
To the big 1 month anniversary special. We're going to take a look right now at some of our favorite moments from the last month.
And dead skin on trial. For what it's worth, it was worth all the while. It's something unpredictable, but in the end it's right. I hope you had the time of your life.
Al Rudnick, Jim Biederman. Jim, can you hear me? We're going to take a look right now at some of our favorite moments from the last month.
Dead skin on trial. For what it's worth, it was worth all the predictable. It's something unpredictable.
Jim Biederman. Jim, we're going to take a look right now at some of our favorite moments.
I hope you had the time of your life.
That was beautiful, wasn't it? Oh, thank you again for coming. This is going to be fantastic. So now I'm going to introduce our first guest. Very exciting. It's our only guest for the evening. I'm very excited. This is a great guy, a great friend. And I haven't talked to this guy for a while because of the virus. Ladies and gentlemen, Joe DeRosa. How you doing, man? Good to see you. Welcome to the show. A year and a half. Yeah, you sent me a very nice video on my birthday. During the first birthday I had in the coronavirus. Oh, what? Joe has no audio. Hold on, here we go.
Sorry.
There we go. Now how about? So here's the thing. Let me just say something to the chat. We know the audio is still messed up. I was working on it this week. You have to hear the audio coming through my computer, and then it goes to you guys. So we're trying to figure it out. And what we've learned is because I do everything on an Apple. I have a PC that I use as a gaming computer, but I do all of my streaming through my Apple laptop because I'm a dummy. And Apple
sucks.
Yeah,
they really suck anymore, man.
Yeah. So
the app, yeah.
So I've been trying to get
off of it.
The Apple?
Yeah, seriously. I'm thinking about going back to PC full time.
I like PC. I was on Android phone. I got rid of the iPhone. I was using just PC, and then I kind of slowly got sucked back in.
You were you were on the Android phone since I've known you, which is not that long. I've probably known you what, 3 years?
Yeah, I would consider you my last friend. I think because you get to a certain age and you pull up the drawbridge. You stop. You're not letting anyone else in. You're not making any more friends. And you and I did. A comedy festival together, the Clusterfest, the first Clusterfest that Comedy Central threw.
Yeah, Jesus, that was where it all started, wasn't it?
Yeah,
and we did that. I did a show with you. I hosted it or something, and you told, it was like everybody had to tell stories about drinking or something like that?
Yeah, so we were doing different little shows around. Yeah, and I think we were telling, there was the show where you would tell drinking stories, and then you and I were on the same bill there.
Yeah.
And I don't know that we'd ever really met before that.
I never met you before that. I only knew you from the TV show, and I thought you were funny, but I'd never met you. And then, so I was excited to meet you at that show. And then we found out quickly that we had a real thirsty, you know, we had a lot of in common when it came to the thirst. So that night was a huge night for me because I became friends with you that night and I became friends with Sal Volcano that night. Oh. That was the night I became friends with both of you. And it was because I drank with both of you separately for an hour at a time at the bar. And that was when my friendship with both of you started.
That's interesting. Yeah. By the way, if you don't know this, Joe has a fantastic show with Sal Volcano called Taste Buds, where get into fights over which food is better, whether it could be Oreos versus moon pies, that kind of thing. And I gotta say, like, I think I agree with you about 70%.
I mean, I feel like it's sort of, everybody I talk to about the show, it's 50-50.
Uh-huh.
Half of them say that I agree with you more, the other half say I agree with Sal more. But I gotta tell you, man, when they disagree, holy shit, dude. I can't believe there are that many people out there that are as passionate and worked up about it as me and Sal are. Because we didn't know if anybody would give a shit when we did it. We're like, people are going to think we're fucking crazy.
No, it's really fascinating. It's fun to watch. And you had a real bullshit take on I forget if it was tacos or what it was, but it was some food where, because I side with you most of the times, and I was like, Joe's out of his fucking mind on this one. Like, you know.
I defended tacos against burgers.
Yeah, that's.
I still will. I still will. I love tacos.
I do too. I did too. But yeah.
Thank you for the plug. Anyway, go ahead.
We met at the Clusterfest and then we started drinking. And I think I hosted a 10 p.m. show that night. Mm-hmm. And after that, so I'd been drinking and then like was just drinking with you and it was immediately like, I like the cut of this guy's jib. And it was like, at the end of the night, I was like, hey, you know, we both live in LA. Let's hang out. And usually you do that and you're like, yeah, but no, okay, sure. And you take the number and you never call. But I remember that night being like, you know what? I'm actually going to call Joe. Like, you know,
I remember saying to you when we swapped numbers, I remember saying to you like, no, dude, like, this is like a real, like, I actually do want to hang out with you.
Yeah.
Like, this isn't like one of these, let's not do what all these other fuckos do out here. Where they, you know, it's the fake, like, you know, definitely, that's everybody's favorite word in Hollywood, definitely, which means I'll never call you.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? And yeah, then, fast friends, man. You started coming over and playing video games and drinking, and that was all we needed.
Well, the amazing thing, by the way, I just found, I got a, they have, White Claw has iced tea now.
Oh, wow.
So this is my first sip of that. I've never tried it.
I don't like that it's raspberry iced tea though.
I have a variety pack. I'll try a lemon one next. It's okay.
Okay, so there is a regular one.
I don't think there's a regular one, but there's lemon is as close to regular as you get.
Yeah. That's I consider lemon iced tea regular iced tea.
Yeah.
I didn't know it came without it until I was in like my 20s. That was all I ever had was the lemon kind. I thought that was just what iced tea was.
But then okay, so then this was I'll just go back into the journey of our friendship. Mm-hmm. And then you, I lived in New York for a long time, as did you.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we were both in LA, and then you said, hey, I had just moved to a new house. And there was a bar very close to my house, and you were like, hey, I'm hanging out at this bar with some friends. Come down and hang out. And I was like, okay. Mm-hmm. And so I went down there, and it was all the old people from New York that I used to drink. It was like all the hardened drinkers from the New York comedy scene. Like you had collected them all, like this island of misfit toys. And it was there. And I was like, it's Jesse Pop. It's like, you know, it's all these guys. And so I knew your entire group of friends. They were like my group of friends from back in New York. So we just fell in very easily kind of thing.
I remember that night. I don't remember exactly what bar it was. I think I do. I don't know if you want to not say, to not give away.
Well, now that I said it's right next to my house, I'd rather not.
Yeah, yeah. So, but I think I remember the bar. I was the same way I was with you. That's how I was with Jesse. I knew Jesse from New York. I didn't really know Vince Averill very well. Mm-hmm. But when Jesse was the first guy I called in LA to hang out with. And I went out to a Chinese buffet with him, that one in Hollywood. I forget what it's called, but we went there for dinner one night. And then he said, I'm going to meet Vince and Vince's girlfriend and Kumail Nanjiani and Emily Gordon at this bar.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, well, I know Kumail a little bit. I know Emily pretty well. I don't know Vince at all. I don't know who his girlfriend is. And then we went, and of course, his girlfriend was Georgia Hardstark. And then we, I was just like immediately, like within like 2 hours, I was like, I think these are going to be like my really good friends.
Yeah.
Well, and I started to hang out with Jesse and Vince all the time, like all the time. So then that night when I invite you over, I go, hey dude, like Trevor Moore is coming over. Do you know him? And I remember Vince being like, yeah, I used to hang with him all the time in New York. And I was like, oh, well, he's on his way. So it was kind of kismet. We all seem to find each other. The guys that like to post up.
The last guys at the bar. Yeah.
Yeah. I really love to post up at a bar, man. I still do. I'm sorry. I don't think I'll ever not like doing that.
Well, then, so then we started hanging out a lot. And then you moved back to New York City.
Yeah.
Which is where you live now.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'll remember, like, I remember this is the last time that I hung out with you. You had already gone back and you had been there for a bit, but you were coming back and like, you know, picking up some things and you said, oh, let's go to this VF hall, this veterans, hall.
Yeah. The American Legion,
the
man.
American Legion, you know?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I miss that place. Ooh, that was a good place.
Yeah. So this was an American Legion hall. You can only be in there if you're the guest of someone who's been in the armed services.
Yeah. And, or if you're sworn in as an honorary colonel, like I am.
Is that what it is? Is that how you, no, but you had a friend that was there who was in the military.
Yeah. John Stites, who's a comic and military. He would produce shows there, mm-hmm. fundraisers basically for the Legion, and or I don't know if it was for the Legion or just for the military in general, whatever. But it was fundraisers, and he would always book me and Burr on these things.
Mm-hmm.
So we would go over and do the shows, and then Burr started bringing me there. Actually, how it really started was Burr and me, our birthdays are close enough together that we would celebrate our birthday together every year.
Mm-hmm.
And one year he was like, this guy, John Stites at the American Legion, he said we can go there and like basically have our like birthday hang over there. And I was like, okay, I guess so. Yeah, like, all right, what does that mean? And so we went and they had a cake and they had all this like, nice whiskey.
Right.
We just got shit-faced at this awesome, like, drinking man's bar in the American Legion. And then John started doing these charity shows there. And he would book me and Bill, and we would hang out there all the time. And then one day he was just like, our thank you to you is going to be, we're going to swear you in after the show on Saturday night as honorary colonels.
Wow.
So then you can come in here and hang out whenever you feel like it. And they did. They did. It was crazy.
That's amazing. So you can wear whatever you want. You can go to Fleet Week. You can wear a suit, and it's not stolen valor because your honor. You've been sworn in.
Yeah, it was a program they had called the Sons of Liberty, and it was as long as your dad or your grandfather served, which both of mine did, then you qualified. And you could get sworn in honorarily.
Watch you like didn't read the fine print and like this shit with Israel and Palestine's gonna pop off and they're gonna start drafting people and they're like, actually, we send over the honorary colonels. Like they're the first in line.
Trust me when I tell you, I have made it extraordinarily clear that I am not military material when I am in that bar. Is this drunk over there? What are you, crazy?
You know, I have no military service in my family. Like
none?
No, we skirted it all. We're rascals. Like we just figured out how to not fight in every war. In fact, and I've told this story on a different show before, but one of my great-great-grandfathers paid a guy to go in his name, and that guy got killed in the war, and his name is on a statue. Like, it's not a statue, but it's one of those memorials, and it was like a family joke. You could go there and see him and be like, he didn't die. He was fine. Oh, like,
it's wild, man. Holy shit.
So,
and he never got in trouble or anything?
Nah.
Like, he never...
Nah.
He,
yeah.
It was a little more of the Wild West back then, man. I used to work, before I did stand-up, one of my last real jobs was I worked at a daycare center for senior citizens that had, like, Alzheimer and Parkinson's. You know, they couldn't be home alone during the day.
Right.
So I worked at the center with them, and they'd come in every day. And there were a lot of guys in there that were telling me they lied. They were only 16, and they lied about their age so they could go fight.
Yeah.
I was like, you could really just kind of fudge things back then. Could you imagine now a situation where you could lie about your age to get into the military? Like,
yeah.
How vetted you are and everything. Like,
some kid in, like, an F-14, he's flying, but he's, like, 8 years old. And they're like, how did you get in here? He's like, I lied.
Yeah. It was wild, man. It was wild. But yeah, that was a fun place. I was just talking to John the other week. Like, I miss that place. I really want to come back to LA. And I think I told you this. You're one of maybe four people I miss from
LA.
Yeah, it's about four.
That sounds right. There's not that many good people out here.
You know, yeah, I miss, you know, it's a real small group, man.
of nice people in LA.
Yeah, you know what? Fuck nice. Of just people that aren't completely full of shit,
right?
Know? Like, you know, but yeah, basically.
Well, you know, I want to say, so the last night I hung out with you, we're getting drinks at the VF Hall. Mm-hmm. I've never been in. You and John were kind enough to let me be the plus one to go in, and I've never drank at the VF Hall. It's mm-hmm. a ton of fun because, like, most of the time you go to a bar, you know, it's like it's dorks, you know. There, yeah. This is a dork-free bar. Like, at the VF Hall, like, you know, we're the dorks at this
right,
bar.
Yeah.
These are people who have fought and served, and they all just look tough and cool and shit, and they're you know, they're not talking about Netflix, you know, they're just like and so we're drinking there, and then there's a call, the bartender gets a call, the music stops, and he goes, I'm sad to say that. And there was an old military guy who used to go there who had passed away. And then they turned off the music. Everybody took a minute of silence because it was a fallen, you know, brother in arms.
Right.
And then the music went back up. And I was like, oh, that's crazy. Like, and so we start drinking. 5 minutes later, another call comes in.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes, another person, you know, an old guy's passed away. Everyone just, and everybody was like, wow, like two in a night. Like, and I was like, that's crazy. And I asked John, I was like, does this happen a lot? He was like, not really. And then before the end of the night, it happened a third time. Three times in one night.
I remember that it was three. Wow, that's wild.
Yeah, it was three. And three old guys had passed away. And it wasn't till months later that I put it together that was the beginning of the coronavirus. That was the beginning of the pandemic. It was in November of that year.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's when it was in the States and we didn't know it was here yet, but it was slowly getting the elderly people. I didn't put that together, but that was my first experience with the coronavirus until, like, months later.
That was a wild, it's a wild time to look back at that couple month period.
Mm-hmm.
My friend, a buddy of mine, I remember it was New Year's Eve and I hadn't seen him because he was out with the flu. He was just mm-hmm. down with the flu. And I was doing shows at the Stand in New York on New Year's Eve. And I remember he came by for a little while to say hi. And it was the first time he had been out of the house in over a week. because he was down with this flu. And I was like, what the fuck did you have, dude? And he was like, I don't know, man. He's like, I never had a flu like that. He goes, I swear to God, I thought I was going to die. My fever hit 104 a couple times. And I was like, Jesus Christ. And he's like, dude, I'm serious. He's like, I really thought I was going to die. And I was like, that's insane, man.
Yeah.
And then cut to a week ago, I was talking to him about it. And he goes, yeah, dude. He goes, the people I got sick from were family members that were from Italy visiting for Christmas. And he was like, and they had a flu and I got it from them. Ugh. And he goes, it had to be fucking Corona. It had to be.
Yeah. Well, I remember it was going around. Everybody was saying like, well, the flu's real bad this year. That was what was because no one knew Corona. And I remember the first time I heard about coronavirus was New Year's Eve. It was actually New Year's Eve. Like, I didn't do much. Like, Sam and his girlfriend came over, and we just kind of, like, hung out on, like, the deck and everything. And then, like, you know, as soon as it became midnight, everybody went home. I was going to bed. And I was looking at, like, a conspiracy forum, as I always do. And there were these people who were focusing on this virus that was happening in China, in Wuhan. And they were talking about like how fast it seems to be spreading, and they were doing this math like these are all kind of crackpot conspiracy people, but like I go on these sites enough that I was like, this one seems real, you know? And so I was really afraid about it, and I was telling my wife, and she like kind of, you know, wasn't really taking it seriously, because I also thought that I could predict earthquakes at one point. Because there was a comet that was heading into the solar system, and every time it lined up with a planet, there'd be a major earthquake. There was one in like Christchurch. Remember all those earthquakes that were happening? So it was about to line up with Earth, and I was like, "There's going to be a huge earthquake. We need to leave Los Angeles." So I like packed up everything, and my wife like just placating me. We went to Las Vegas for a week. Just to like, you know, because I was like, everyone's gonna die in Los Angeles, and then and then like 4 days in, my wife is just kind of smugly being like, seems fine, like that, and I'm like hoping for the earthquake just so I don't look like a fucking idiot, you know?
Yeah, no, of course, yeah, you want to be right,
yeah,
you want to be right, yeah.
So it
no,
did,
man. It was at the time, it last winter, not last winter, the winter before 2020 winter. I don't do the show anymore, but I had just launched a podcast with Corinne Fisher that was called Without a Country, where we were going to try to find like a sort of common ground with news stories, because everything was so tribal and polarized, you know? And that was the whole goal of the show. And I remember, I think it was our second episode. It might've even been our first. We were talking about these stories that, by the way, were fucking buried about coronavirus and this thing that was happening in China. And I remember at the time Trump was talking the only news that you were hearing about it was Trump was talking about shutting down our borders to China, not letting anybody travel in from China. And, you know, he was getting a lot of flack for it and a lot of heat, obviously. And I remember saying on the show, I was like, Corinne, like, I'm not a fan of this guy. And I understand why people might want to call bullshit on this, the thing that he's trying to do. But I'm reading these stories. They're tenting cities in China. This sounds like Black Plague shit. I was like, what the fuck is going on right now? And I remember we were both like, this is odd. You know, you can scratch your head. Like, you know, and then the next thing you know, it's like, I remember, dude, I the last show I did before the lockdown, I did the Comedy Central TV show from the Comedy Cellar. This week at the Comedy Cellar. And the way that show works is you get booked, like basically the week of, you get sent some talking points, you do your own material, and then you try to write some new stuff about the news. And I remember I went up to the stand to run my set before I went down to tape. And I went into the green room and Paul Italia, the owner, goes, Tom Cruise has coronavirus. And I was like, what? And I immediately went to the cellar, went on stage, everybody in the room had been in there for hours taping the show.
Mm-hmm.
And I got up and I got to be the guy that was like, hey, everybody, Tom Cruise has coronavirus. Here we go. This is real. Did my set, went home. Everything shut down like 2 days later, which worked very advantageously for me and my set because Comedy Central had to cut the season short. So they used the shit out of everything they shot in that last week. So my set got a lot of traction because they needed content. You know, it was fucking wild, dude. And yeah. I remember the one other thing I'll say and then I'll shut up. Sorry.
No.
Jay Oakerson and Dan Soder do this radio show called The Bonfire.
Mm-hmm.
And I go on the show a lot and stuff. And I remember when they did the full lockdown finally, Jay called me and he goes, we have to do The Bonfire from home over Zoom. Why don't you sit in and be the third mic for the quarantine and we'll make it a bit and we'll call you the quarantine third mic. And we'll do it just for 2 weeks.
Right.
Until we get to go back into the studio. And cut to, I swear to God, 3 months later, I called Jay and I was like, dude, I can't do this with you anymore. This is like a full-time job. Yeah, like, this is crazy, dude. Like,
that's
it was just fucking nuts, man.
Yeah, you know, it's you talking about that Tom Cruise thing. When Whitney Houston died,
yeah.
Well, Whitest Kids was doing a show at the Trocadero in Philly. Rest in peace. I don't think that's a place anymore, but
I think it's there, but it's not the same or something. Yeah,
but we were doing a show there and we were mid show and my step cousin had actually come to see the show and he was like in the wings like that, and I like go off, I'd finished a sketch and I walked off and then he was just like, Whitney Houston just died. And I was like, mm-hmm. Really? And he was like, yeah. And I'm like, had the same thing where it's like, well, I got to tell people. And so, like, right. I walked out into the sketch and just basically, like, threw it into the middle of the sketch. Like, by the way, this really happened. Whitney Houston died. And then I tried to go back into the sketch. And everybody's kind of like, you lose the entire audience because everyone just starts looking at their phones like that. And it was like, oh, yeah, that was dumb. But
That's so funny. Yeah, you think it's going to be this big moment.
Yeah.
And it's this crazy, unique, weird situation to break some insane news. And you're just like, oh, yeah, this is not what I thought it was.
Oh, this derails everything.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. Who's the guest? It's Joe DeRosa. Joe DeRosa.
I'm looking at some of the comments. Some people are saying some very nice things, but you know how this goes.
Yes. They'll be mean.
Yeah, there's some viciousness popping off, but it's okay.
What are the vicious ones? I always like to see the mean stuff.
So I actually was going to laugh at it. I think it was when I was telling the Tom Hanks story. Some guy goes, Joe, that's not even a story.
Oh.
Yeah, Joe DeBlosa. There you go.
Oh, here's Joe, you are the shit. That's good. That's nice.
Joe, I heard your schlong is massive. Yeah, keep those comments coming. Eat my ass, Joe. That could be a good one. It could be I don't know.
You know, so I have, as you do, probably... I have friends from both sides of the political spectrum, and
I wouldn't admit that in the city you live in.
Oh, I don't care. But I got friends on both sides, and so I have some friends that didn't take this thing seriously at all.
Right.
You know, and sure. I found them to be the most comforting to talk to, because mm-hmm. like as everyone in the worst part of it, I was terrified of it like that. But I have this one friend. And I would call him and it'd be like, I don't know, it's looking bad. He's like, look, dude, when I start seeing high school quarterbacks dropping dead, that'll be something. Then I'll be worried. But until then, like, which is like, it doesn't make any sense. He goes, and then at one point he goes, look, I'm not sweating something that Rita Hanks shook off. which is a great way to put it. And as incorrect as that could be, it still makes you feel good when you're freaking out. Like,
yeah, no, that's great. My whole thing and excuse me. My whole thing was, and you know, we can talk about something else. I'm sure people are coroned out, but my whole thing with this I just got to a point. I saw Jamie Kilstein say a thing where he goes, "How about this? Just don't be a dick." Mm-hmm. You don't want to wear a mask? Okay, don't be a dick. You want to wear a mask? Okay, don't be a dick. And it's like, yeah, can everybody just do that? Like, can you just not be a dick? Like, yeah. I don't give a fuck. You know, I'm in Best Buy. The sales guy is talking to me about sound bars. He's got his mask down, spits popping out of his face. I didn't give a shit. I just didn't care.
Right.
What I didn't, and I didn't walk away. But what I didn't feel the need to do was either go, this needs to be okay for everybody, or yell at him to pull his mask up. It's just like, you're able to just kind of walk away. And once you started to learn the real science of how this works, what exposure is really classified as, what outside versus inside meant and all that, and then you still saw people being complete fucking assholes.
Yeah.
I just was like, isn't there enough room for everybody to fucking breathe, man? Like, it's just so strange to me, this fear of I have to hammer my thoughts and beliefs into the other guy's head.
Well, it's
because
it's,
if I don't, my apartment or my house is going to get taken by storm or something. It's just like, what?
Yeah,
I don't know.
It's very fun to be righteously angry at someone, even if it's not, but to feel righteously angry. Like, even if it's not righteously angry, it's like a very addicting, you know, thing. Like, sure. I know if I know that I'm right and somebody's like acting up and I can like make a scene, and if I don't like this person, nothing makes me happier in the world than like if I know I'm right about something. And I think that that's just like a lot of people just get addicted to like, oh, now I can yell. We love yelling at people. And it's like, oh, I can yell at somebody because their mask isn't over their nose or something like that. Like, that's,
I think it's so odd to me. Like, and my philosophy has always been, if I don't like what that group is doing over there, I don't go to that group.
Right.
That's it. Like, I had a bit in my act about Arizona at one point, you know, and the premise was just like, I'm so fucking sick and tired of people in this country yelling at me about Arizona. Quarantine the fucking place and turn your back on it. Like, just don't go to Arizona anymore. Why are we waiting for this big epiphany to happen?
Wait, what's going on with Arizona? Oh, the recount?
It was just, you know, they were the last state to recognize Martin Luther King Day. Got into all the immigration, whatever. Here's the thing. Some people politically believed with a lot of the sort of stern stances that Arizona took on things. Some people harshly disagreed with it.
Right.
If it doesn't bother you and you're into it, then live in Arizona. Great.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not into it and you're disgusted by it, then don't live in fucking Arizona.
Right.
And I think like that's what's starting to happen now. You know, Carlin had a joke about the beheadings, and he was like, you know, he was basically like, you don't want to get beheaded, stay the fuck out of that country then. You know, like, they're going to get a little pissed when you go walking around with a machine gun on your shoulder over there, you know? And like, it's harsh, but it's funny, and I do think there's truth to it. And I think what we're seeing now is, I think truly what you're going to see now in this country is the truly defined and separated red and blue states, where it's just like, hey man, I live in New York. Why do I live here? Because I love the city and I agree with most of the people I talk to here.
Mm-hmm.
It's the right environment for me. That's what I like. I wouldn't like Arizona because it would be too conservative for me. I don't like LA because it's too liberal for me.
Right.
New York, for some reason, just kind of strokes me right where I want it to, and I like it. And I just don't get this hang up. I understand that I'm not saying that everybody should just have the luxury to relocate. I understand all that. That's not what I'm saying. But I also just don't get this thing of, like, we have to make everything the way we want it at all times. You know, everything needs, you know, it's the analogy I always use. It's quinoa bowls at McDonald's, when McDonald's did that for a while. Well, they should have a quinoa option for me. No, they shouldn't. You shouldn't go to McDonald's if you don't want to eat fucking Big Macs. That's it. Like, McDonald's doesn't need to adjust to you. Go to the place that you like, you know? So, anyway, sorry.
Chat is divided. You have divided chat.
I divided the chat?
They are divided. There are some people who are very upset at your take. Some people are 100% for it. But that's great. That's what we want. We want this to be a safe place for everyone.
Who's disagreeing?
I don't know. It's all there's all these names. They go pretty fast.
It does really, man.
Somebody says you are missing, Trevor. The flagship is missing. Some people are not into this. People are.
Are we supposed to be doing other stuff?
No, this is. Like, I mean, I don't. Things? I'm. Okay. It's okay. Like I like talking about. You know what I think is funny is like. As soon
as somebody just wrote, read the donations, you coward.
Okay, let me do that. Actually, let me do that. Let me read some donations here.
All right. God damn it. A meme comment really makes me laugh.
No, they're
suck
pretty
a dick, Joe.
They're pretty good. All right, I got to read. Okay, somebody resubscribed, said perfect material. Someone said, woo, woo, woo. Brant Crantley said, woo, woo, woo. Doll Lickers, go fuck yourselves. It's Crunchy Dan. Subscribe and said anniversaries on anniversaries. Beep beep, I'm asleep. Said my sub anniversaries on the flagship anniversary. Woot. Wolf the Mongler said woo woo woo. A lot of woo woo woos here. Okay, JJ Marvin donated $10. Said Trevor sold out. Why do you look like wrestler Edge?
Yeah, you do look like Edge. I never put my finger on that.
A little bit. M12 Sarge donated $20. Said, can't believe you actually read the donos. Loving the flagship show. It's nice. Okay. Lint Trap said, Trevor is fantastic. That's good. That's nice. Oh, No Mission donated $25. Said, I hope this doesn't get read. I donated just because the flagship hits without reading donos. Oh, so they didn't want me to read that. All right. So yeah, if you put in donations, we will read them. I figured out how to do it. It's happening. You know,
right.
Good job, Trevor. You're doing it. All right, we're
you
doing good.
77% in the polls here. That's a landslide victory.
Oh yeah, no. Well, there's every episode somebody says it's a miss.
Yeah,
it's fine. It's part of it. Yeah. I thought so. Comedy was gone. For a year.
Yeah.
Wasn't happening. They stopped.
Yeah.
No more comedy.
Mm-hmm.
And then it started to, and like it's, and then it just started opening back up. And I swear to God, in the first weekend that they started doing shows again, there was that Tony Hinchcliffe thing.
Yeah.
That went on. And it just reminded me of like how there was a year with no school shootings. And then all of a sudden when things started opening up, you know, there's like 3 weeks where there was like a shooting every other day. They weren't at schools, but they were like at malls and stuff like that. And it was like, oh, right. Yeah. Like, it's like this whole thing that we've been trying to get back to. Like, you're like, oh, now this fucking slaughterhouse is operational again. Like,
well, I know Tony, I know he doesn't have hate in his heart. I think he made a clumsy maneuver. And
I'm not asking you to
Oh no, I know. But you know, it was a wild approach to a commentary.
Right.
that I guess because the kid in front of him was doing a bunch of stuff about like everybody needs to be nicer to Asian people. Mm-hmm. And then Tony's like gag was like, what if I went up and said the worst things possible?
Right.
But it was a little fist at elbows.
I mean, it's a risky thing to do.
It's risky. It's risky. It's hard, man. I don't know. Like I gotta say, like with stand up and everything, just with the sort of climate we're living in these days, I do a little bit of stand up in New York. I have no plans to go back on the road. In fact, I canceled a bunch of stuff.
You're getting into sandwiches now, right?
Yeah, I'm doing sandwiches and you know, opening a space and doing these podcasts and writing stuff. And I don't know, like I'm not leaving entertainment. I'm just like, I have no desire to go on the road and tour right now. And whenever I do, then I will. But I do like, I still do like getting up there and doing it, but it is weird. It's weird. It's like, And that's not a finger point at any one side of that political aisle. It's just everybody is so on fucking edge. And, you know, it's just a weird, it's hard to figure out how to navigate those waters. Like, it didn't used to be that hard.
Right.
It was kind of like, you know, you'd go to a show in like the 2005 and you'd see Janine Garofalo and then Nick DiPaolo immediately afterwards.
Right.
And they were completely different politically. They were completely different perspective wise. They would both kill. And then you'd see them hanging out and talking after the show and laughing.
Right.
And you just don't see that now. Like, it's just, man, it's so fucking tribalistic. And I don't know.
Well, I was just reading something today. This kind of goes into the news about, there's an Associated Press reporter who, I guess she had said some anti-Israel things in college on Twitter.
Okay.
And so in this whole Israel-Palestine thing that was coming out, that's coming out. Yeah, it turns out what's coming out about Israel and Palestine is it's not going well.
I think I heard a few things about that.
Yeah, they're canceling each other. The right wing pulled up her tweets and got her fired from AP, even though these were tweets she made back in college, you know.
And they were pro-Israel or anti-Israel. Okay.
And so she did a thing being like, this is cancel culture, you know, the right is canceling me. But then the right is always saying cancel culture, and then the left is always like, cancel culture is not a thing. But then this threw me, because then I was like, well, now, so it's like, and as someone like, there's not a whole lot I have much of an opinion on, like, you know, like, but it seems very weird that everyone's, it's even contentious whether or not the thing that people are mad about actually exists, you know, like that's the fight is whether or not a thing is a thing, you know.
It's a, yeah, dude, it's a scene, man. We're in the trench. We're in the trench of the Death Star right now.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a couple people in the X-Wings going, guys, does anybody else feel bad that we're about to blow this whole thing up, kill a bunch of people? I don't know if we should do this right now. You know what I mean? And everybody's like, no, fuck that shit. You know, like, so I'm just like, I don't know, man. It's a weird time, dude. It's a weird, weird time.
Yeah.
You know,
I know a lot of people. But, I know a lot of people are very I'm not that bothered by cancel stuff. You know, I don't think.
Yeah.
Because partly is, like, I think it's overblown to a certain extent. I mean, like, I think you can get, well, so I think you can get canceled for assault shit. Like that, yeah, you'll get canceled, and you should. You know, that's, you get canceled for good. But the people who, like, get canceled for, like, a joke, I don't feel like they're actually really getting canceled. Like, you know, they may have to go away for a little bit, but I'm trying to think of, like.
It depends. Yeah, I think there's a lot of factors to it.
Mm-hmm.
I think the people that get shoved away permanently, a lot of the time, it's a Marilyn Manson situation where when that Marilyn Manson shit dropped, I never saw anybody get canceled that quick over anything.
But people hated him for other, but that wasn't what I'm saying. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. You start talking to some people that knew a guy who knew a guy, and you start hearing like,
yeah,
this is insane. This person has been bad. Da 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 da.
Someone in chat says Shane Gillis did, but I also think Shane will be fine.
Shane's one of my dearest friends, and look, I'll say this: Shane went through hell. I feel for him completely. I support him completely. I think it was unfair what happened to him. But he is working, and Shane's a great guy. So I do think that, like, he will have the opportunity to carve out his little part of all of this business or whatever. Whereas Marilyn Manson, granted, is walking away a millionaire, multimillionaire, probably. I don't think that guy's ever coming back. You know what I mean? Like, when Kevin Spacey went, I was like, he's not coming back. That one, he's done.
Well, it's done. Also, it's not like the
machine. Might have a fighting chance to come back. I really do.
It's not like the machine was making much money off Marilyn Manson anymore. That's also the big thing. Like, you know, Marilyn Manson, you know, he doesn't look cool anymore. He looks like a big puffy, like, pillow person. And so, like, you know, like they just sort of, you know, but also his stuff was more of the assaulty stuff. It wasn't.
Well, yeah, no, exactly. Yeah. And then, you know, apparently, allegedly, I should say, he had a history of this behavior. But look, man, I'm of this philosophy, and I say this all the time on. I have a movie podcast called "We'll See You in Hell." I say this all the time to my co-host Pat on the show, because we read news stories every episode at some point about what's happening in the movie business. Mm-hmm. And 90% of the time it's backlash over X, Y, and Z. Here's the thing. If you're looking toward Hollywood to be the ethical, sound, we support you at all costs industry that you want it to be, you're a fucking moron. It's like going down to Wall Street and saying, you know, these investment bankers are good guys. Like, they really believe in me. No, they don't.
Right.
You're a commodity. If you're making them money, it's great. If they need to get rid of you to save the ship for themselves, they will. Stop looking to Hollywood things. Stop looking to the industry that created all of these problems. Okay? In entertainment to begin with. It wasn't us out here creating rings of child sex and assaulting the secretaries and doing all these awful things and jerking off into plants and putting racist characters into movies and all this horrible shit.
Mm-hmm.
It was them. And then they turn around and go, well, you know, we got to fix these problems. It's like, you started all the fucking problems. And then they start canceling people because they're trying to make themselves look good. Some of them deserve it. Some of them don't. So it's just like, stop looking to Hollywood to do the right thing. It's so stupid. It's like, look at this. You and me, two old buddies, we're on fucking Twitch right now. What have you made? 16, 17 bucks tonight? You know what I mean? Like, you can make your money out there.
Yeah. Yeah. There's no gatekeepers anymore. The gate has collapsed. I can make $35 a night on this thing. No one can take that away from me. Actually, Twitch will cancel you in a heartbeat. They will. Like, you know, if you show like a male nipple, they'll take you out. They'll kick you out.
Yeah, I mean, and that's part of it too. Like, you know, we do a lot of our stuff on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And there's, you know, there's YouTube has its problems, it has its issues. I mean, look, anytime you're dealing with a platform, that platform is, look, they're going to do what they want to do, and they have the right to. It's their platform. It's annoying as shit, you know? I get really irritated, like, on Instagram when, like somebody shows, like, a boob, and it's, like, some anti-censorship thing on Instagram. It's like, that's not censorship. You're on Instagram, and Instagram is allowed to have Instagram rules.
Yeah. You know what?
That's
everyone,
not what censorship is.
It seems like people are mad because our takes are not crazy. I think they're saying these are boring takes. We have to like spice it up. Let's think for a second and come up with a crazy take about canceling.
I'd like to see another movie from Harvey Weinstein.
Who would like? Well, I still love fucking Mel Gibson. You know,
I said from the jump with Mel Gibson when I heard those tapes, I was like, I think this is a guy off his meds.
Right.
He sounds like he's mentally. He sounded manic, dude. I know people that have had manic breakdowns. He sounded manic.
Well, this is how he started. So I won't go into the whole thing, but I know a guy who was drinking with him the night of the incident. Yeah, I knew the guy who took all those pictures that they put in all the tabloids, and he made a fucking fortune off of them. He was just hanging out at a Malibu bar with two girls. Mel Gibson comes up and is drinking out of this giant water bottle all night, and they're like, he's trashed, and they're like, what's in that? He's like, it's my special water, and he's like drinking it, and then And like, so my friend was taking pictures of him and everything like that. And then they're like, are you okay to drive? And he's like, yeah. And then he got arrested. And so the guy that I knew, he was like, well, God, I have these pictures. I'm not going to. And then he heard about all the stuff that Mel Gibson said. He's like, well, fuck him. I'll make money off it then. Like, you know, but and he's not like a good friend. It's kind of a sleazy thing to do. But here's how, you know, this guy was, there's something wrong. Like this is how he started the conversation. When, like, the very first thing that he does, before all of the anti-Semitism and everything, like, the cop walks up to his window and he goes, what's the problem, sweet tits? So that, right off the bat, you know, this there's something off kilter here.
He was in a bad way, you know? And, you know, look, I don't know. It's...
Apocalypto is a sick fucking movie.
It is. Look, I still like Tom Cruise. I mean, you know, he's part of that goddamn church that does God knows what over there, you know?
No, they're going to end up being right. Watch them end up being right.
I know.
Now, as they're, like, disclosing all this alien shit, like, you know, it's always going to be the loopiest, the crazy, the most bananas religion that's going to end up being like, that was the one? Like, that would be the twist at the end of the story. Like,
yeah, I know. I mean, it's just, you know. Anyway, let's talk about a fun thing. What do you got?
But, all right, should we look at the news?
Let's go to the news.
All right.
Yeah.
Now, so the premise of this show originally was that this was a show called Newsboys, and Zach Kreger and I did it, and then and we would talk about the news, but we would, because we don't pay attention to the news all week, so like we're very uninformed. So then we look at it and then come up with a take right there. I'm looking. Oh, so here's something we could talk about. So this Bill Gates guy.
Yeah.
You heard about this?
No. What did he do? Everybody's mad at him right now, right?
Yeah. Well, he microchipped all of us and people are pissed.
He did?
He put in the vaccine, he put a fucking microchip that's in all of, you can go on TikTok, you can, kids are putting magnets on their arms, it's sticking to their arms. No. that is,
wow, that'd be awesome.
No, but like people are, people, so he was always like, his persona was like, I'm just a big dork, you know, like I'm a safe dork. And I've always thought that the scariest people in the fucking world are nerds who get a little bit of power because they have a chip on their shoulder. High school wasn't good for them. Like, and it's always like they're trying to make up for, and they're angry. Nothing's more angry than a nerd.
Yeah.
And so like, they're trying to like, you know, get back at the world and like women, they become real mean to women because women didn't pay attention to them in high school.
It's one of the things I hate. It's one of the things I can't stand about certain comic books. Is like I'm trying to read like a comic book and I'm getting distracted because there's a comic book about Oz and it's such like a cool fucking idea about like the you know, the witches taking over and the it's kind of like that movie or that thing Wicked, you know. It's like the socio-political version of Oz. It's really fucking cool, but every fucking woman in it is dressed like, it's ridiculous, like her ass is hanging out and she has triple F boobs and whatever. And you're just like, what nerd is drawing this right now?
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Well, it's also it's a little ridiculous that you're like, I want like jocks to be drawing my Wizard of Oz comic book. I mean, but what nerd is drawing this?
Like, this is like this is like stupid looking.
What? Oh, hey,
what happened?
I've got to go upstairs real quick.
No. Wait, you can't leave me here. Are you serious?
I have to.
What are you talking about?
My wife, I need to go up and like move a car.
This is insane.
Is this
a bit?
No, it's not a bit. Is that
all right?
Is that cool?
Yeah, go ahead.
Can you take over the show for like 2 minutes?
Yeah.
That's so rude. I'm sorry.
That's fine. I'm going to answer questions. Guys, ask me anything.
I'll be right back.
It's an ask me anything. But you got to... move a car. He had to move. I'll try to keep up with these questions. Joe, how do you feel about Red Bar? I think Red Bar is really funny, man. I told him that. He DM'd me once, and I told him, I was like, I don't know, dude. I think you're funny. A lot of comics hate your guts, but I don't know. You make me laugh. You can't be mad at the guy. It's like, all we do is shit on everything. I go on O&A for 5 fucking years straight. All we did was shit on everybody. When I go on Kumia, we just shit on everybody. When I go on The Bonfire, we just shit on everybody. It's like, I don't understand why comics are so mad at him. He's shitting on people. That's what they do. It's funny, man. I don't know. I think he's really funny. Joe, how do you feel about Shane Smith? I like Shane. I don't know him incredibly well, but I've always liked him. Is Sal really that cool? Yes, he is. Are you QAnon? No. I don't hate boobs, but God damn it, I don't want them all over my eyes. You know what I mean? It's weird. I'm reading about like the Cowardly Lion, and there's like triple G cleavage next to his head. It's too much. Were you with Bill Burr when he did mushrooms for the first time? No. Did he? Is that true? Did he talk? Did he do that? Joe, are you going to give us how's the new season of Better Call Saul? I don't know. They're shooting it. But I'm sure it's great. Joe, are you going to give us a Bill Burr story? Yeah, I got a new one, a funny one. He called me. So he's got that podcast with Verzi now called Anything Better. It's a funny show. So Bill and I now, we don't talk on the phone. We just send each other audio messages all the time. That's the only way we communicate. That's the only way I communicate with Sal, too. And he sent me an audio message the other day talking about how Verzi called him up, talking about the Sons of Sam documentary on Netflix. And he said Verzi really, really bought into this thing. Like he really believes that all of it's true, which I don't know if it is or not. But he said that Verzi goes, Burr, he was not working alone. David Berkowitz was not working alone. And Burr goes, oh yeah, how do you know that, Paul? And he said, Verzi goes, because he said it. And Burr goes, oh yeah, Verzi, the guy that talks to dogs said he wasn't working alone. Oh man, that made me laugh. All right, shut your dirty mouth. Okay. Oh damn, that doc was great though. I want to see it, man. Do I know Tux? Shit, it's gone. Joe, tell Trevor to restart the OBS. What does that mean, guys? You're gonna have to dumb it down. This is my first time on Twitch ever. Do some mini food debates with Trevor. Okay. What do you think of Tim Dillon? I've known Tim for a long time. He's funny, man. He's funny. He's doing great. Holy shit, man. He's killing it right now. What stand-up spots in NYC do you recommend? I would say go to The Stand. Go to the Comedy Cellar. Go to Gotham, New York Comedy Club. Those are my 4 favorite clubs. Is Chris Gethard a jerk? No, he's always been nice whenever I've met him. I'm not being diplomatic. He really has always been nice.
Dude, you kept the audience.
I'm just answering questions.
Nice job. Was that
Bill told the Verzi story on Conan? Are you shitting me? That fucking, you know what? That's what he does. He calls you and he runs his goddamn sit down fucking bits by you. You think you're getting a special interaction and he's going, oh God, that's so funny. I told a Burr story. He called me the other day and left me a really funny message. And somebody just said he told that story on Conan the other night.
Oh, that's fine. Yeah, you guys are super, super tight. Anyway, sorry. Just to go back a little bit to the, people say lag is really bad. I don't know what to do about that.
By the way, start over the OBS or some shit.
But won't that make that'll make the whole thing restart?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Joe, by the way, was that the least professional thing that's ever happened to you in an interview?
I mean, you know, sure, but what are we doing here? We're not doing a late night NBC show. Yeah, it's like, no, who cares?
Yeah. You talk about I don't really think you can really get canceled for jokes, you know? I think you can have to go away a little bit, you know, but like I'm not worried about it or anything like that. The other thing is I also think you have to be very famous to be canceled. So it's like if you stay below the radar, you're fine.
Well, and it depends on, and this is not me apologizing in any way, shape, or form for cancel culture, because I have shit on it plenty, and I've gotten plenty of fucking heat for talking about it publicly, including phone calls from friends, Trevor, who have told me, in the comedy friends who have called me and said, you need to really open your mind and, you know.
Hey, Joe, can we pause for a second? I'm going to restart OBS because I just looked at it and it is horrible.
Okay. Well, this guy just said you guys are fine.
I'm going to restart OBS. I might have to restart.
It is bad.
It's pretty bad. Okay, so everybody hang on. I'm going to stop OBS. I'm going to restart it. All right. We'll be right back in a second. Somebody says, is Trevor's PC made of cardboard? Which is funny. Okay.
Are we back in?
We're back.
Somebody just asked me a question that I do want to address. They said, can you please talk about M&M's being a candy bar after the restart? So we did an episode recently at Taste Buds where we debated Snickers versus Kit Kat.
Uh-huh.
And Sal, I don't know where it was coming from. He got on this kick where he kept insisting that M&M's counted as a candy bar.
That's insane.
And I kept saying, yeah, I was like, no, they're candy. They're not a candy bar. And he kept going, same difference. And I was like, it's not the same difference. We're talking about candy bars. And it's the most mad I've ever been on the show. I literally at one point stood up and had to like walk in like a small circle. You know what I mean? Because I was just like, I had steam coming out of my ears.
Well, that's an insane thing to say.
It made me crazy. Huh?
That's an insane thing to say.
It's nuts, right?
It's not even connected to reality.
Yes.
I mean, at that point, you're like, well, then what is not a candy bar to you? Are peanuts a candy bar by themselves? Like, because it's the same size. Like, what was his argument?
He claimed to me once that chocolate chips counted as a snack.
I'd buy that.
No. I was like, what are you, a lunatic? It's a baking product. Who the fuck buys like a bag of chocolate chips and sits there eating them?
Big fat guys.
It's crazy.
Big fat guys do. Big fat guys will just eat cookie dough.
I saw a fat dude meal recently. I was laughing so fucking hard. One of my favorite things to see is when a fat dude is eating something at a restaurant that I've never seen the restaurant have.
Oh, I offended a bunch of people with that because people are like, I feel attacked. Trevor, shut the fuck up. I do that. Like, people are mad about eating cookie dough. Sorry.
No, cookie dough? That's fine. We're not talking about cookie. We're talking about chocolate chips.
But I said cookie dough. I threw that in. Yeah, you're talking about just eating baking products. Well, you ever see just a big fat guy just eating a bag of flour?
Who hasn't? No, I saw this. I saw, he's a friend of mine, but I saw he was sitting across from me at a club, and he was at the next table over with some other comics, and I was with my buddy Sherrod Small, and we looked over, and he was eating a basket of chicken, and we were laughing so fucking hard. I go, dude, this place not only doesn't have chicken, they don't have baskets. I was like, these guys are so plugged in with the off menu. Trust me, they got it. They got it. It was so funny, man.
So I'm sorry. What did I interrupted you? Oh, to restart the OBS. You were talking about. Do you remember?
You said, was that the most unprofessional thing that's ever happened?
Yeah, no, but I think we'd gone back to talking about, you said like some people had told you that you have to, or had changed your opinion on canceling or something like that.
I have been scolded. I've been scolded a couple times now by comedian friends who have called me and said, you need to be careful about what you're defending and what you're attacking, and you're going to be on the wrong side of history. And so my point is I am not apologizing for cancel culture in any way, shape, or form, because I've been scolded for attacking it plenty of times. What I was going to say, though, is, you know, cancellation, part of it is you got to define what cancellation really is.
Right.
And you know, that's why I kind of say the Hollywood thing. It's like, I've kind of come to terms with like, hey man, I'm never going to be on a multicam sitcom ever again. You know what I mean? So if I get banned, like in the way that a lot of comics get booted or banned or canceled, it's kind of irrelevant because it's like, yeah, but I'm not doing those things. I don't want to, what am I going to do? You know,
like, right.
I'm not gunning to get the leading role on the CBS TV show anymore.
Yeah.
It's just not where my interests lie. So I don't know. I think you can still work and still function.
Yeah.
And to some extent, some people, not yeah. everybody.
I don't think it's that big of a deal. People are like, I think people are tired of talking about cancel culture. I keep bringing it back to it, but it was all off of that one article. We were talking about the news and then I was like, well, there was an AP article. And then I brought it back again. So it's me. I keep doing it. So I apologize to chat. We'll stop talking about cancel culture. If it is such a thing, if there is a thing, who knows? Is there anything that you really take seriously? Like, is there an issue? Because I don't have an issue that I really like, you know, have you been offended? Like, is there a thing that like would offend you?
It's tough. I mean, not particularly. I get a little I would never act on this. I would never do anything about it. I get a little offended sometimes when somebody dismisses me and just goes, oh, well, you're white and you don't get it, whatever. Like,
right.
for multiple reasons. Number one, that's just shitty. Like, that's just shitty. Just don't do that. Like,
but also, aren't you Middle Eastern?
Huh?
Aren't you Middle Eastern?
That's the second part of it.
Oh.
The second part of it is, well, I'm Middle Eastern. So, and I'm Arab. So what you're saying is offensive on two levels.
Right.
And I just don't like that flipping, you know, I don't like that. Again, I'm not going to cry in my fucking milk over it. You know, it's like, I'm not going to get mad about it. I'm not going to whatever. But it's like, that's the one thing I think that I can think of where I get like irked in a way where I'm like, I don't care for that right now.
Right.
You know, but that and my I get very offended on behalf of other people that I care about.
Uh-huh.
You know, so like if somebody's shitty to you.
Right.
I get offended for that. I always want to jump into the fight. On behalf of a friend or something.
Well, that's a good thing, I guess.
You know, what about you?
No, I'm real bad at taking shit seriously. Like, I'm real bad at it. Like, I, you know, even if someone, like, yeah, I don't know. Like, you know, the reason I bring it up, because I was actually thinking about it the other day, and I was like, what's, like, being offended? Like, you know, kind of thing. And people are saying I'm still talking about cancel culture. I'm not. Is this the same thing? Am I talking about this? Is this the same thing?
No, it's just, it's who cares?
Okay.
You know, it's just, you know, it's who cares?
Yeah.
You know?
No, I don't get like, you know, I honestly voted in this election because I felt like everyone was going to be mad at me if I didn't vote. Because people were mad at me for, I voted for Edward Snowden, like, the first election, the first Trump election, I voted. I didn't like Hillary and I didn't like Trump. So I was like, I voted for Edward Snowden. And then everybody, all my friends treated me as if like I was the guy that made Trump president. And they're like, you know, and I'm like, it didn't come down. It was nowhere near close to like a vote, my vote in California, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And also I didn't like Hillary Clinton. Like I don't want to vote for people I don't like. I like Edward Snowden, you know?
I got you.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not, I love talking about it because I think there's part of me that likes watching people get riled up. So I love being at a party where people are talking about it. And then I'm like, what about this? Like, you know, kind of thing. But like, I'm just kind of being an ass. I'm just kind of like, oh, but what about this? And then watching how people get like, you know, kind of worked up.
You have a little more, Joker in you than I do. You know?
I have damage tattooed across my head.
Yeah, yeah. But you have a little more Joker in you than you do. You know, I'm good friends with Ari Shaffir, and Ari's got an air of that in him. He's got a little bit of like, let's just see what happens if I say this.
Yeah.
You know? I don't have that. I get like a little like I get a little too hung up on accountability and contradiction. Lack of accountability and contradictory behavior drives me up a fucking wall.
Mm-hmm.
I get so fucking mad. And that's why I'm not good at kind of throwing things into a conversation like that, because I'll get angry, not about not being offended, like what we were just talking about with the, like, you know, well, you don't look Arab, that whole thing that I get all the time, right?
Right.
I get so, I don't give a fuck that you're insulting my heritage or my, I don't care. I really don't.
You could
put a towel on your head and hump a stuffed camel in front of me and I wouldn't be offended. I just don't, you're not going to offend me with that. It's idiotic to me. But what I get hung up on is the part where I'm like, don't you see that if you're saying I pass for X, Y, or Z, that's the same thing as saying that races have stereotypical features and that's something that you would find offensive. Mm-hmm. I'll get so caught up on that contradiction that I will become incensed over the somebody's willingness to just throw away logic because they want to be right in the argument. That's the part that
a lack of self-awareness. Is that,
it's not even, I don't think it's even self-awareness. It's that it's, and I think a lot of people do this now. And you know, like we live in this perpetual, everything is spite and everything is, I just want to win the argument. So you see people blatantly denying things that they know are true or just being so contradictory. And when you're calling them on, it's like I feel like every social or political debate now, it's like arguing religion.
Mm-hmm.
And it's and how arguing religion used to be. And when you would get into a religious debate with somebody, you would say, how can you tell me that your God loves me, but if I eat meat on Friday, I will burn in hell because he's that spiteful? And they would just go, no, you don't get it. You don't get it. It's like, no, I do get it.
Mm-hmm.
That's a contradiction. Explain to me how you can tell me you have love in your heart, yet you think gay people are evil.
Mm-hmm.
Explain it to me. And they would just deny the contradiction because that recognizing the contradiction would mean that they were wrong.
But what if God, what if God's like a crazy alien? Like, because, you know, if like, an you know how, like, God could be an alien?
Right. Yeah. The Planters theory, to read about
right,
that.
Right. Yeah, what if it was, what if it is an alien who's, like that?
I used to have a joke about that. I go, can you imagine if, like, right-wing Christians, like the real hardcore ones, like the Baptist, Westboro Baptist, whatever the fuck that church is called. Uh-huh. I was like, what if they're right? What if that is who God is? Like, I was like, we are fucked.
He's like an alien who's like, who's like, all right, I'm going to leave you guys, but no dudes getting together because that's gross. Yeah. Like, you know.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. So I don't know, man. That's the shit that kills me. But you know, dude, I don't get offended. You could tell me any joke. You could say any word to me. Like, you know what I mean? If I'm not into it, I'm not into it. But that's your problem,
right?
You know.
So I think. Well, let's try to go away from like heavy stuff.
Yeah, you think?
Yeah, let's have a lighthearted conversation.
All right.
Although I'm enjoying this, I'm just trying to, you know what? It's fine. Chat can be upset. It's fine.
They're upset.
We're still holding numbers. No, we're good. We're good. With Bill Gates. We were talking about Bill Gates.
Oh yeah. Why is everybody mad at him again?
Because he's like, he left Melinda Gates.
Wife?
Yeah, Melinda Gates. Cause so here's the thing. Bill Gates was always being like, I'm just a safe dork, you know, which is, we got into that whole thing about how dorks are the most dangerous, you know. And
that's right, I forgot.
Yeah, yeah. And so he's like, I'm just a safe dork. Like, you know, I don't even have a sex drive. You know, like I just love calculators. That's like, that's the image he wanted to put out there. But at the whole time, turns out that he's like playing grab ass at Microsoft. And so,
oh, shit.
And when he had to step down, last year. Like, I always thought it was like because he was part of like the Illuminati or some shit, and he knew about the coronavirus, so he wanted to get out with his like, you know, when his shares were worth a certain amount. But it turns out it was because they caught him like, you know, like honking some intern or something, and then in the closet, and then they basically like, you know, they kicked him out, but they made it look like he just left. And this is all allegedly.
Was it consensual? Or was he like groping and stuff?
I don't know. But I think the thing is, if you're the boss of the company, they're saying like it's still inappropriate. Yeah. And then the other thing is they're saying Melinda Gates already also left him because, and this is what I didn't know. Well, I knew he was friends with Jeffrey Epstein. You know Jeffrey Epstein? You heard of this guy?
Heard of this guy. Did you watch the documentary?
No.
The only new information in that doc, because they already leaked everything out before the documentary. Mm-hmm. But I still watch the documentary. And the only new thing I learned was that he was fucking cheap. Because in the documentary, they got into the money he paid the girls. You know, be like, he would give a 15-year-old girl $150 to come to his golden mansion. Nope. I was like, Jesus, he's cheap on top of it.
A friend of one of my best friends was one of the girls.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
What'd she say? Did you got any inside info?
I've never met her, but my friend was like, dude, what the fuck? And he told me, like, you know, it kind of. But this, she was like a girl like 20 years ago kind of thing. But it's the guy's been doing it forever. So he was friends with Jeffrey Epstein. He was on that fucking, what do they call that airplane? Like child fuck airplane or something. Like he named it something like that was super obvious. Like,
I don't know. Does anybody in the chat know what the,
I think that's what it was. I think it was child fuck airplane. That was the first red flag.
Lolita Express. That is what it was called, right?
Yeah, that's just as bad, honestly.
That's horrible, dude.
Yeah, and so Bill Gates was friends with him, but it wasn't like, you know, he was friends with him way back in the day, and then this stuff came out. He was friends with him. He met him after the allegations and after he got out of prison. Then Bill Gates was like, "What's up, dude? Like, we have things in common." Like, you know, kind of like. And so that's what Melinda Gates is like, one of the reasons she's leaving him. Allegedly.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
I didn't know that about Gates, that he befriended him after.
Yeah. I mean, I guess you could be like, well, that's a really big thing of him to like reach out for somebody who probably isn't getting a lot of friends at that point. Like, you know, but that sounds like bullshit.
Well, I mean, I don't know, dude. It's like those guys, they were in like a club of, I mean, how many people in the world have the kind of money they have, you know?
Like, yeah.
God only knows what justifications you're making at that point in time.
Yeah.
Or why you're making them or whatever. But yeah, that sucks, man. That's a bummer. That's a real bummer.
It's just insane that they couldn't like, I don't know. Like, it's crazy that, like, why does it always seem like all the people on that roster were like the biggest people in the world?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's wild though. When you watch the documentary about him, he had his skill set was he could talk a good game and he was a schmooze, but like he just talked his way up the fucking ladder. It was nuts. And people are like, dude, he would do anything to get ahead. Anything.
Yeah.
You know, that's why when you're watching those depositions, they keep asking him, like, did you ever have sex with this man? Because they're asking him that because what supposedly happened was, like, he fuck a powerful dude so he could get into the company and, like, whatever. Epstein would? You know? What's that?
Epstein would?
Yeah. And it was like, and he was, like, for all intents and purposes, a straight man.
Right.
But, like, you know, but then, like, his, like, the reason they're asking about his sexual conquest with men was because it was tied directly to his positioning at a company that allowed him to do this. It was all part of the chain of dominoes. And it's crazy. And then, I was watching that at the same time I was watching the Jimmy Iovine Dr. Dre one.
Mm-hmm.
And Jimmy Iovine and Epstein, it was so interesting because they were cut from such similar cloth initially in life. They were like these scrappy street kids from Brooklyn or wherever, you know? And watching both of those simultaneously, you got to see like, this is what happens when the guy does it all correctly and actually does something good with his abilities. And
right.
This is what happens when the other guy goes the other way. It was really interesting, interesting watch.
Yeah, although I don't trust anybody now. I'm looking at everybody like, I don't know, Dr. Dre. I don't know. I don't
well,
know.
Well, Iovine.
Somebody said, by the way, thanks for lightening it up, guys.
We're going to lighten it up with some Epstein's material. This is one of the reasons I don't know if I want to do stand-up anymore. This is where my head always goes with this shit, man. Like, it's real tough, man.
So you're not going to tour? You're not going to tour anymore?
I mean, if I ever do, it will be 100% on my own terms.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I really got into the routine over the last 20 years of touring to pay the rent, and I'm not going to do that anymore.
Right.
It's just not healthy. It's not a healthy way to, for me.
Well, it's a miserable experience, you know, like,
and it can be,
and like, you know, I think I've said this before, but like, you know, we've done a good amount of on the road, like, you know, stuff, you know, for years and stuff. But I'm out there with, usually when I go out, I'm either with two or three of my like best friends in the world. And it's still such a lonely experience, you know, because it's the sitting in the hotel room and then, you know, then looking around, what do I do in this fucking city all day until the show? And then it's like, do I drink with people after the show? But then I got to get up and do radio in the morning. Like, I know all this sounds like, you know, like, oh, boo hoo. But like, it gets very lonely and kind of, I don't know. Is that what you don't like about it or?
Well, I mean, all the stuff I don't like about it now is all the stuff I initially loved about it.
Mm-hmm.
All of that stuff is a lot of fun for 18 years, and then you start to be like, all right, you know, or whatever. But, you know, once, you know, I used to get excited to go to the airport and get onto a plane and to fly someplace to do comedy. I thought it was insane. I couldn't even wrap my head around it. And I thought it was really fun and cool to get to go on morning radio shows and be funny and do these things. And I thought it was really cool to have three shows on a Friday night. And I thought it was really cool to meet people after the show and then go out and drink with them or the wait staff or whatever. And then, I'm so hungover today. You know what I mean? Sleep all day on Saturday, but you know, that's rock and roll, baby. All right. I'm eating a basket of chicken fingers and hitting the stage again. All of that stuff was really romanticized for a long time because it's life on the road. But you know, eventually, and look, for some people it doesn't wear off, but for me, eventually it wore off. And I was just like, I don't want to live out here anymore. Like I love New York. I want to live in New York. And if I go on the road, I want it to be a special event that I'm looking forward to and doing it because I want to do it and I'm going to enjoy it. What I don't want to do is get uprooted twice a month when I don't want to leave because I have to keep the lights on. That's the part of it I didn't like. Right. I always loved doing the shows. I always loved meeting the fans. Like that part of it, and I mean that, that was always as pure and beautiful an experience from the first time up to the last time. But everything else, dealing with the bachelorette parties, dealing with the weather, dealing with the plane delays, dealing with the eating in the airport, dealing with the shit food at night, dealing with rushing dinner from a shitty bar menu at the club, you know, in between shows, dealing with, am I drinking too much? Dealing with, you know, the guy that these guys are keep asking me to go back to their place and party, you know, and like, all of that shit, dude.
Right.
It was just like, you know, it was fun. It was fun for a long fucking time, but eventually like you don't want the war stories anymore.
Yeah.
Know?
Yeah, you know what was like a big change for like me on the road is is because I used to have like a group of people with me, so it was kind of like you were invincible, you know, like after the show, people would be like, hey, we're a fraternity. And we have got to come by and see this fraternity. We're having a party. And you'd be like, sure, there's five of us. You know, like we can all keep each other in check. Like, you know, kind of thing. Like, you know, you're all. And then one by one, Timmy and I are the only people who still drink in the group. Like everybody else kind of sobered up. And so then like people started to go to the hotels afterwards. And I was like, well, I'm not going to go hang out. By myself with people, like, because who knows? Like, you know, like I could get murdered. They could take my kidneys, like, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah,
and and that was a bummer.
Well, I mean, look, here's the thing: it's a blessing, and it's a very lucky thing that very few people get to do, and it's great. That doesn't mean that it can't become too much of a good thing after a while. You know, somebody just wrote, "Oh, come on, Joe. Here's what you got to understand, like." I think there's a certain illusion that people have about what it's like to be out there. But I'll tell you the number one thing that you need to realize about the touring lifestyle for a lot of bands that are not up here and most comedians, you know, I'm not talking about Louis C.K. and Burr and guys that are doing these big theater shows and whatever. I'm talking about the average comic like me or Trevor or whatever, where you've got some fans that are coming out, but you're doing smaller venues and things like that, you know? You're out there on your own. You're not safely protected on a tour bus with a tour manager, with security. It's like, you know how many fucking times I've been threatened by an audience member who the club is not kicking out, by the way? Like somebody getting up in the middle of the show and literally threatening you? It's like, after that happens X amount of times, you just start to be like, I don't feel like fucking dealing with it anymore, man. You know, you get shit thrown at you. You know, some guy's waiting outside because he got kicked out. And now he's pissed off. And you've got a 22-year-old waitress that's going to walk you. It's like, what? You know, like club doesn't have security. It's like, you know, I mean, it's just, you're out there on your own, man. It's not a business trip. Your company isn't flying you out. You know, you're in a fucking hotel room that smells like mildew because the air conditioner leaks and that's it, you know, it's kind of gross.
The, people are saying the lag's bad again.
Yeah, well, I might just be boring it to a halt.
No, you're doing great. You're doing
great. What is Whore Town? Why do people keep saying Whore Town?
Oh, that's what they name themselves.
That's great.
This chat is called Whore Town.
I love it.
Yeah.
I love it. I didn't know the chat had a name. That's great.
Well, we got, like, I might restart OBS one more time just to get us to the end here.
Hey, that's on you, buddy.
All right, I'm gonna go
pee.
Everybody, stay with us. Joe's gonna go pee. We're gonna keep it light for the rest of it. I've enjoyed this. I mean, he's gone. All right. I'm gonna restart OBS. Everybody, come back now. It's gonna get real light in a second. What's up, everybody? Can you hear me? What is up? I don't know if anybody can hear me. Can you guys hear me? Joe, you there?
Yo.
We're back.
We're back. It's rebooted?
Yep, rebooted. Everything's doing great. Is the video going? Hold on. I'm going to refresh my screen. And let's see. All right. Guys, I don't know what to tell you about the video. Like, I guess I'm going to have to. I've been doing this on a laptop, and I guess that's not the way to do it. So maybe I'll switch over to my gaming PC before next week. Let's do a poll. I still think this is a hit. I do. I enjoy talking about, and here's the thing, this is what we'd actually be talking about at a bar anyway, you know?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah,
probably.
It's kind of dark stuff.
It's also I'm embarrassed to admit, a little late for me.
Oh yeah, you're on the East Coast.
When I don't go out, I go to bed at like 10 p.m. No joke.
Really?
Yeah. If I don't go out, I'm like, I'm in bed by 10 and like fast asleep by midnight.
You know?
But if I go out, then all bets are off.
Well, let's find a lighthearted news story.
Sure.
I'm going to. The first story I saw was not lighthearted at all. I just went to Drudge Report, and the thing that was in red was Jewish man beaten in Times Square. That was like, let's skip that one. What else we got?
I mean, there's no good. Is there any good news? I mean, you know, there's got to be something. Is there? Click on you know when it tells you the news categories. Click on zany.
Zany?
Is that one? Is there a zany tab where you can pick a...
Oh, Prince Harry tells Oprah mom's death led him to drugs, accuses royals of neglect. Now,
which
I'm
one's
so
Harry? Is that Meghan Markle?
Yeah, I'm so fucking sick of Prince Harry. I don't know why. I think it's the Irish in me, but I can't stand the royal family. And
annoying.
And what I don't like about Prince Harry is that he's trying to be like a celebrity over here.
Right.
And it's like, you have a whole fucking country to be a celebrity at. You have a country that fucking pays for everything you do. They fucking suck your nuts all day long. Like, you can just stay there and be, but he's like, I got to come over here to the colonies. And then he starts suing paparazzi for like flying a drone over his house. I'm like, I'm just fucking like, either, you know, if you don't want like paparazzi, if you don't want to be like in the limelight, A, right, don't move to Los Angeles. Don't fucking do interviews with Oprah. Don't like, I don't know. I just, I like.
He Donnie Brasco'd that family, dude.
And they suck too.
He brought an outsider. I'm not saying they don't suck, but he brought an outsider in. That was like, he brought Johnny Depp right into this. Man, she went right on Oprah, spilled all the shit. They were just like, what the fuck?
See, I like that. I like that part of it. When she's like, hey, guess what? You know this, family that kidnapped Africa? Yeah, turns out they're fucking racists. So that, I mean, that's great, but I don't buy the whole like, oh, and like, and then he signs a deal with Netflix for $100 million, like he's gonna produce like fucking shows for them.
I mean, just fuck off, dude. Who is going to stop Netflix? This is insane. This is insane, the money they're spending. Where are they getting this money from?
I don't know. It doesn't. It's like, how does any of this make money? Like, they used to be like, you know, like they start just, you know, raising money for these like software things, but no one really knows how to make money off of the internet, really. I think that's kind of, I mean, I'm sure Google's figured it out. But yeah, Netflix, well, I mean, how many subscribers do they have? They're all paying $15 a month. That's a lot.
Dude, they announced that I think they said they're spending, it was some insane number, dude. I couldn't, are they doing, who's doing the Lord of the Rings show, by the
way? That's Amazon. They're paying $1 billion for a TV show.
But at least with Amazon, I understand where the money's coming from. It's Amazon.
Sure.
The country is, I mean, the company is wildly successful.
Yes.
Like, wildly. It's like, so it makes a little more sense. I still think it's gross that they're spending $1 billion on a fucking Lord of the Rings show.
I just hate that story so much. I fucking hate that story. Like,
so boring, dude.
It's the lamest. And they made the movies and everybody was like, it's incredible. And you, like, I watched all of them like a fucking dope. Because like I was like, it's a cultural thing. Let me watch this. But it's like, it's Lord of the Rings is worse than the Marvel movies.
It was so boring, dude. The Clerks 2 argument about Lord of the Rings versus Star Wars is so fucking great. When the kid goes, Return of the King won an Oscar, and Randall goes, there's only one return, you fucking nerd, and it's of the Jedi. but he just sums it all up so perfectly. He's like, that whole fucking trilogy was just people walking. It's like, yeah, it was, dude. It's just like,
somebody says,
so fucking boring, dude. And they fight the same exact bad guys in every scene in the exact same setting. There is no like, well, now they're in space, or now they're on a space station, or now they're on this desert planet. There's none of that. Everything is a big grassy field with stones in it. And they're fighting the orcs again.
And I don't.
So fucking boring.
Yeah. I don't like elves. I don't like. Somebody said, yeah, but Trevor thinks the Star Wars prequels are better than Lord of the Rings. I do. And I was about to say,
I'm a prequel defender myself.
I love them. And I was about to say, I don't like fantasy, but that's not true because Star Wars fantasy. But I don't like elves. I don't like dragons.
Right.
I don't like princesses. I don't like, I like space. I like astronauts. I like movies about astronauts.
Say again?
I like movies about astronauts, and that at its heart, isn't that what Star Wars is? It's a movie about a couple of astronaut friends.
I love a space battle.
Mm-hmm.
I could give two shits about an astronaut movie. It's one of my least favorite genre of movies.
Oh, are you watching the men?
Anytime I see McConaughey come in and he's going to go meet his dad on Pluto or whatever, I'm like, oh, I don't give a fuck about this.
I love space. You got to watch this show. It's on it's on Apple or something. It's called We All Go to the Moon. It's about what if the moon landing was the Russians?
Okay.
Like they did it first. And then, but you got to check it out. It's called We All Go to the Moon or something. And it's really good. I'm really into it.
I would hate that so much, dude. Dude, I would hate that. That's up there with, like, the remains of the day. Like, period piece movies. I hate that shit so much. If there's ruffles in a movie on clothing, I'm out, dude. I'm fucking out.
Yes.
Unless it's pirates. Maybe then I'll stick with
pirates
around,
are okay, you know? But yeah, I don't like any of that Jane Dickinson or whatever it's called. Is it Jane Dickinson or
Emily Dickinson?
Emily Dickinson. Jane Dickinson, somebody else. But like Emily Dickinson, where it's like Sense and Sensibility. All that shit's horrible. Ugh. Like but how can you
it's
that,
horrible.
But astronaut movies. Astronaut movies aren't like that. Astronaut movies are great.
I'm just telling you my least favorite genres. Just I hate. Oh, that one where they talked an octopus. What was that one?
Oh, My Octopus Arrival. Alien. My Octopus Alien. No, wait. Arrival. Yeah. Somebody says
Arrival.
Right here. Somebody says it's called Jane All Austin. Mankind? The TV show I'm talking about is called All Mankind. It's not We All Go to the Moon. But, like, you got to watch this show. It's so
we
good.
All go to the moon. I thought that was the real title.
Yeah, no, it's called For All Mankind, but it's really good. I like astronaut stuff. Do you think you'll ever, if you had the money, would you go up in one of those Elon Musk rockets and look at space?
I guess. I don't know. Like, I guess so. It's so never going to happen. I can't even speculate on if I would do it or not.
It'd
like,
be kind of a,
I will never have the money for that. Huh?
But like, so like, but say it's dropped in your lap. Like somebody's like, oh, I'm friends with a guy. You can be on the ship. You can go up there. You'd go?
Yeah. What do you can't say no. It's like if somebody's like, do you want to go to the deepest? We're gonna go to the deepest part of the ocean. I got you a seat.
Oh, yeah, see, sure. I wouldn't do that. I'd go to space, but I wouldn't go to the ocean. I hate the ocean.
Deep ocean freaks me out, dude.
Yeah, I hate it. I don't like it.
But space would freak me out too. The vastness of it would freak me out, dude.
I'd rather because be it's, in the vastness of space than something with like a fucking goddamn squid monster. Have you seen the, like the fish that are at the bottom of the ocean are like they're demons. They're basically demons.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the thing that sucks about space though is that it's the opposite. There's nothing. It's not like you go up there and you see the Millennium Falcon like flying around. You're up there and it's like you're alone, dude. you're alone up here. Like, that freaks me out a little
but
bit.
But the view is cool, you know? Like, you've got sure. a view. Like, you know, like, you don't, there's no view in the ocean. It's just dark. And then if you do see something, it's something that's just about to bite you. And it looks horrific. Looks like the worst thing you've ever seen, and then you're dead.
What's it called? Used to freak me out. The journey to the, what was it called? 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, the ride at Disney World?
Yeah.
Did you ever go on that? And then the squid attacks the ship?
Yeah.
That was always really freaky. And then Space Mountain used to freak me out too, because it was like dark and like you'd see like asteroids and stars and shit. That freaked me out.
That one freaks me out because I'm so tall that like when it's going through, it makes it seem like the ceiling is like going right over your head. And I'm always like, what if they hadn't planned it for people like me? Like, you know.
Yeah. Something. Yeah.
Which I know they have.
Yeah, I hear you. Pirates of the Caribbean, the part where you're in the rowboat and the two ships are shooting over your head. And mm-hmm. it's like a dark, stormy night. That's used to freak me out, too.
Hey, Joe, you ever see a ghost? The chat just asked that. I'm a good interviewer, aren't I? Like, I have great transitions.
I don't think I have. I feel like I have a story that's like ghost related, and I'm just blanking right now. I would love to know that ghosts are real. I would love to know.
Do you think they are?
I don't know. I think it's a much greater possibility that interdimensional crossover stuff happens and then it looks like a ghost. But what you're really doing is peering into an alternate reality. I think that's way more plausible than the idea of a dead spirit roaming the earth. But
right.
But man, I would love to know that ghosts are real. I just want confirmation of an afterlife.
Right.
I just want that so bad. I am so afraid of dying.
Really?
I just want to know something happens after this. Yeah. Yeah.
You want something to happen after this?
Huh?
You want something to happen after this?
Yeah. What do you just want to be dead?
Yes.
No.
Aren't you tired?
Yeah, but you want to go through
a whole life and then be like, now we start again. Like, oh my God, we just did this.
Life is so unfair and downright cruel to many people. Not if it just ends when it ends, it's like, what the fuck was the point? Like, I don't know, man.
Yeah. I remember when I was a kid, because I grew up super conservative, religious.
Yeah.
And the idea of an afterlife really freaked me out. And
why?
Because it bummed me out. Like, the idea of eternity. Like, you know, like, oh, my God. Because also, as a kid, I hadn't done drugs yet. And I didn't really have a grasp on eternity. Like, I was like, well, it's just time that never stops. Where it's like, well, no, it's outside of time. Like, now I get that. But at the time, it's just like, oh, it just goes on forever kind of thing.
Right.
So I remember as a kid, I would be like, well, here's my plan. Here's what I'll do. I'll be real good, you know. I'll get to heaven, and then I'll wait in line to talk to God. It'll probably take, you know, centuries, because everyone's gonna want to do that. Like, you know, that's got to be the main attraction when you go up there.
Right.
You know, that's like going on the Cars ride at Disneyland.
right.
And so, but then when I get to them, I'll just be like, hey. Love it. This is all great. I would like to not exist, if that's cool. That would be my heaven, you know? And then I was like, so that was my plan as a kid. You know, that was how I could compartmentalize being okay with an eternity.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to live forever, dude.
Oh.
I want to live forever, dude. Like, I don't want to, there's so much shit to do.
What?
I mean, I'm not doing
what is there
of it.
To do?
I'm not doing any of it. I say that. Then I'm bitching about flying. Like, I don't want to fly to Ohio. Yeah,
what is there to do? I mean,
yeah.
Like, I don't want to die until I'm an old man. I would like to do it, like, to place pretty well. Like, I always think of, like, if I, you know, what if you get out of life and then, you know, you kind of take your head out of a headset and all your friends are there. And they're like, holy shit, you really believed it. Like, you really thought you were, like, you should have seen you during that. And it was like, it took 5 minutes. It's like a game that everybody does in the afterlife where they put themselves into, like, 3D reality and it seems like a lifetime. you know, I want to have a good score. Like, I don't, I want to go a long time, like do like, right. like a, at least hit the average lifespan, you know?
Yeah. Well, it's interesting. There was another net, I can't remember the name of it, but there was another Netflix series about this. And the first episode focuses solely on, is there an afterlife? And they've got like, it's crazy, dude. They've got like hard science, like doctors in this thing that say like, I had a legitimate near-death experience or like died and came back, whatever the fuck that's called. And they were like, I fully believe there is an afterlife now. I was a complete atheist. I believed in nothing. I was like, you're crazy. When you die, you're dead. And after this experience, I am not only do I believe, I am 100% convinced. And, right. And every one of them says the same thing. They're like, I don't take life seriously at all anymore because I know I'm graduating to this other thing. Like, I have a peace about me that I've never had. Like, just seemed like a really positive thing, but.
Yeah. See, I'm not an atheist. Which is, I'm in a weird thing where, like, I believe in God. I just hope there's no afterlife.
So you believe in God, but then you think.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Right?
Man, that's hot takes.
That's a weird Venn diagram, right?
Yeah, it's very weird.
Yeah.
It's very weird, you know? Yeah, well, shit, dude. Like, look, knock on wood. Hope I don't die in my sleep tonight.
Hey, you made it through Corona. That's pretty good.
I had it. Yeah.
Me
I didn't
too.
Even feel it.
I didn't feel it either.
I felt like I had hay fever.
I didn't feel anything. What I did is...
I just felt like I had hay fever.
Disney tested me 3 times a week. And then they were like, you have coronavirus. And I was like, oh, it's like, could it be a false, you know, thing? They're like, nope. And they're like, because the false ones come back. It's like multiple people come back false.
Right.
You know, like, because then it's like something went wrong with the sampling. They're like, we tested the entire crew. You're the only person that came back. Like,
that's probably what happened with the Yankees. That's why I was like, 8 Yankees test pot. It's like, come on, something's not right there. Yeah.
They're like, you got it. And so what I did is I just loaded up, I've said this a bunch of times, but I loaded up a car with tequila and pot. I drove up to the beach and I basically did a last stand up there where I was like, all right, I'm just going to either ride this thing out. And if I go, yeah, it'll be a cool week. It'll be a fun week. Good way to go. And if I beat it, then I'll always get to say, this is how I beat it. And so that's how I rolled the dice. And it was great. I never felt the thing, you know?
Wow. That's awesome.
Yeah.
By the way, my niece, her favorite TV show is Just Roll With It.
Oh, really?
And she freaked out when she saw me on it.
Oh, yeah. Hold on. I'll show. I actually have this loaded in because I wanted to get into your life.
Yeah, you know, we got nowhere near it.
Like, I know we didn't. We just talked about cancel culture. But here, let me see if I can. Boom. There's Joe in Just Roll With It.
You gotta send me some. Yeah, there it is. You have T-shirts or something, send them to me. I told her I would try to get a T-shirt for her or something.
All right.
She loves that show.
Yeah. You thank you for doing that, by the way. You played the laser tag owner.
Yeah. Is it still going? Are you guys doing more?
No, we're done because we did 2 seasons, but now they're not sure when they're going to bring in live audiences ever again. Like, it could be years before they have audiences sitting in. And so much of that thing was audience participation kind of thing.
Why, though? Why can't they just do proof of vaccination for the audiences?
I don't know. It's just, like, everyone's being very, like, you know. And also, this was a decision that was made, like, 6 months ago. So who knows? It might be getting better now. But, like,
That sucks, man.
We're moving on. Yeah.
That sucks. I'm sorry to hear that, buddy.
Oh, no, it's fine.
Yeah. Well, listen, dude, I love you. This was fun.
I love you too, dude. This was great. It was nice catching up and hanging out.
Yeah, man. You should come out to New York and hang out, dude.
I think I might come out there. Yeah.
I'm going to be coming out there at some point. I got to make some rounds, you know? So.
All right.
One way or the other, let's hang out, man.
All right, I'm down. Like, let's let me know when you come out here, and then I'm gonna plan coming out there pretty soon. So
awesome,
Cool. Thank you. I can't thank you enough for staying up late. And
yeah, no. Thank you for having me, man. I enjoyed it. Thank you to all the fans and everybody in the chat. Thanks for having me, guys. I had a good time. And check out Taste Buds.
So this is Joe. Do you go on Cumtown?
I've never been. I'm friends with Stavros, but I've never
been. Oh, someone said, get on Cumtown. Yeah, they don't have guests on that show, I don't think, do they?
I don't know if they do. Yeah. I don't think they do, though.
You're on all of them, though. You're on Opie and Anthony. You're on everything, aren't you?
Well, Opie and Anthony's not around anymore. But, yeah, I do Jim and Sam and Kumia and, Kumia and Bennington. Bonfire, you know, a lot of the shows. That's so
you guys,
it's all good, man. It's all good. Like when we we're talking about maybe doing some Taste Buds where we bring in guests. So when we do that, you should come on.
I would love to. If you're late catching us, please go see Taste Buds, Joe's show. It's fantastic. Yeah. I love
it. You can find it on YouTube on the No Presh Network channel. Video episodes every Monday, 11 a.m. EST. Audio wherever you get it every week. And we'll see you in hell. Back catalog available everywhere. And then new episodes on patreon.com/WSYIH podcast. That's it, brother.
Awesome. I'm going to read a quick dono right here. $3, Speedpunk, 1996 says, when you're not pissing off people, that's when you're doing bad. P.S. Can you find the jerk off who stole my Amazon package with my shoes in it? $10 from Prefix Suffix 26. Good old flagship, never missing. Super excited about role-playing game coming back. Let's go to Mars, y'all. And cheer, cheer, cheer. Let's see. Punches Baby says, let's go, boys. 1990 said, fuck yeah, Joe, you fucking rock. That's nice.
Oh, thank you. That's very nice.
And Mitchie Richie donated $10. So three more weeks.
Thank you, Richie.
Someone said, free gifts, said, I was on your side before, but now you're missing. Okay. It's nice to end on a negative one. That's always cool. Joe, can you stay on for a second? I'd love to say hey afterwards.
Sure.
We're going to raid Fantastic Plastics. But first, everybody, thank you for watching. This has been the 1 month anniversary show of the flagship, and we'll see you next week.